So our next panel is going to delve into something that touches many of our lives, which is nowadays the on-demand economy. And for this panel, I'm delighted that we have lined up the Dean of Stanford's Graduate School of Business to moderate, Jon Levin. Jon Levin is my friend and colleague. He's been at Stanford for 17 years. And along with John Chauvin, I got to know him through the recruitment process, myself coming out here to Stanford. He is a recipient of the John Bates Clark Medal as the most outstanding economist in the US under the age of 40, who make the most significant contributions to economic thought and knowledge. He earned his bachelor's in math and English from Stanford, then went to Oxford for his degree, a master's in economics, and finally got his PhD in economics at MIT. And he's been here at Stanford now for 17 years, first in the economics department, and recently joining the Graduate School of Business as a dean. So I'm going to welcome him, and he is going to introduce our two terrific panelists. So please join me in welcoming John.
Thank you, Mark. And it's great to have the opportunity to be here at the SIEPR Summit. It's always one of my favorite events of the year. And welcome to the session on the on-demand economy. As Mark said, this is both topical and timely. It's going to be an opportunity for us to talk about job creation and the effect that on-demand platforms are having on our lives, about the type of work they're creating and the type of products they're creating, about regulation. I hope maybe a bit about automation as well. And we have two great panelists to do that with us. The first is Diana Farrell. Diana is the president and the CEO of the JPMorgan Chase Institute. She was previously the global head of the McKinsey Center for Government. Diana's worked in Washington in a senior role. She was the deputy director of the National Economic Council. Diana only has one black mark on her gold-plated resume, which is that she went to business school at another institution that I won't name. Our other panelist is Betsy Masiello. She is the director of public policy and economics at Uber, and she previously led global public policy work at Google. And she too was at McKinsey. She started her career at McKinsey. And in keeping with the summit, Betsy has a graduate degree in economics. She got that from Oxford, where she was a Rhodes Scholar. So I'm going to kick off the panel. I'm going to invite Diana to come up, and she's going to give some remarks. Then Betsy will give some remarks. Then we'll have some moderated Q&A. And then we'll open it up to the audience to have a discussion. So Diana, you're on first.
Stand up to give the remarks. I thought I was going to do it from there. Thank you. I'm very honored and tough to follow Steve Hadley, but we're going to go from the geopolitical to probably one of the more interesting micro developments in the economy that is particularly well suited to the work that the JPMorgan Chase Institute does. Why? Because it's relatively nascent. And the traditional data sources that are out there to understand what's happening in the labor markets, as good as they are, the BLS, the census, just aren't picking up a lot of this. And so what we're talking about today is the on-demand economy, the gig economy. We call it the online platform economy because we're trying to zoom in on what about this is new and different. There have always been gigs. We've always had plumbers. We've always had people who work music gigs and otherwise. But what we would argue is different about what's happening with the on-demand economy right now is defined by four elements. One is that these are online platforms that connect sellers or service providers directly with customers, that workers get to pick when they work, not employers get to pick when they work, that the payment is a form of piecemeal payment. So you get paid for a task or a service on a one-off basis, and that the financial intermediation for those transactions is taking place on a platform, not directly between the provider and the buyer. And with this definition, you begin to understand what we're talking about, this online platform economy. It's all the platforms that we categorize as labor platforms. So you provide a task or service, share riding, Uber, Lyft, walk a dog, Instacart, you name it. And very importantly, capital platforms, where you're selling a good directly online, or you're renting an asset, such as Etsy or Airbnb, for example. So keep that in mind as at least I describe what I think we're talking about in this new development in the labor market. The narrative that exists out there in the market is this is the evolution of workplace going forward. We're now all in the gig economy. That's what we're doing. People are increasingly relying on gigs. They have multiple gigs. Very hard question to answer by the traditional data sources. And that's where we come in. So the JPMorgan Chase Institute is a relatively new venture. I came from McKinsey, where I ran the McKinsey Global Institute and a few other centers to launch and lead it. And what we have is an independent platform that allows us access to all of the bank's de-identified data to develop data assets to inform the economy about what's really happening, particularly where traditional data sources fall short. So in this case, we were able to identify 250,000 participants in the online platform, so 250,000 people who are earning income on these various platforms. And because of the window we can see this over time, longitudinal for 3 years. We observe other sources of income. So how does this fit into their total earnings? And we have a range of demographics about them. What's their location, their residence, their age, their income level, their gender? And that begins to provide a very rich picture that, as I said, does not really exist easily out there, except for surveys that have all kinds of complications of their own. So what are the highlights that I would provide for you just to frame the discussion of what that I think is maybe a little different than the narrative that I started with, that is the conventional view? We estimate that the level of participation today, any given month, is 1% of adults are somehow earning income on these platforms. Now, importantly, they come in and out of it. So if you look cumulatively over the past 3 years, about 4% of adults have at one point or another earned income on these platforms. So that's a lot. That's 10 million Americans that are participating in it. But it's certainly not the future of work. I mean, it's an important dynamic. Maybe made more important because it's growing so rapidly. So in these last 3 years, when it really got started, we've seen a 47-fold increase in the participation. Even on the monthly view, it's a 10-fold increase. So it's really quite dramatic. And it's meaningful. I mean, the monthly earnings in the form of capital are about $1,250 a month. In the form of labor, just over $1,000 a month. So it's a meaningful. It varies dramatically across the country. So in cities like San Francisco, you have 5% or more of adults participating. In other cities, the numbers are half that. Houston would be a low end of it. And again, the earnings that are being earned vary dramatically, with New York at $2,500, Miami at only $500. I think it's really important in the world that describes the gig economy to recognize that the capital platforms are actually a bigger part of the story than the labor platforms, although obviously at kind of 60%, 40%, both are pretty important. The other thing that we find with the view that we have is that counter to the narrative that people are doing multiple gigs and signing up to many of these platforms, the crossover is relatively limited. So in labor platforms, you do have about 18% of people who will participate in more than one, say an Uber driver also on Lyft or some such. For capital platforms, only 3% of people will participate in more than one, and only 1% will do labor and capital at once. So it's really not this idea that people are taking on multiple gigs, as I said. I mentioned that what's interesting about this is the growth, and the longitudinal view we have has given us a really interesting view on the growth. The year-on-year growth rates to achieve that 47-fold increase are phenomenal. In the early years, it was 300 to 400% per year. Now, interestingly, that growth rate peaked in 2014. And while it's still growing at very high rates, it's now down to 100 to 200% per year. So we really have seen a peak in this as it relates to participants on the online platforms. When it relates to earnings, the cumulative level of monthly earnings on this platform, there's been a rapid deceleration since 2013. So off the bat, there was a lot of growth. You know, again, 500% kind of growth for the first couple of years, and it's been decelerating. Labor platforms actually saw a decline in total earnings of 6% in the last year, even though the participation rates have gone up. And that's mostly because of the price pressure and the wage cuts that many of these have experienced. So that's the growth. Let me share just a few highlights about what we know about the people who participate in these platforms, because it really begins to inform the policy discussion about what one might want to do, if anything, about this. So the demographics, by and large, both labor and capital are a younger crowd. That's particularly true for labor platforms. We're really concentrated in folks 18 to 34 years old, although you'd be surprised that you do see participants across the age group. For labor platforms, it's a man story. 67% of participants are men in most of these. We have, you know, a third women still, but that's a big difference from, say, the capital platforms, where it's really more 50-50. We see very active participation across all income quintiles, as would be expected. Labor platforms tend to attract lower quintile, income quintile participants, but there are still pretty active people across the board. And we see, as I said, active participation across all age groups. Even the plus 65-year-olds are participating at the rate of almost 0.5%. So across the board. Very important to note, again, counter to the narrative, that it's sporadic engagement. People will get on the platform, but then maybe not particularly participate much after that. Of the people who join, we don't see them again earning income, except only 41% will earn income again in the next several months. In the case of labor, 16% of capital. Maybe the most important thing, and this links to other work we've done, is the role that it plays relative to other sources of income. So for the majority of participants, this is a supplemental form of income. It is a very small number of people who are relying on this as their primary source of income. We estimate that it's between 20 and 30% of total income. Most of the participants actually have some other source of income, and typically a traditional source of income, meaning a payroll. And that's, I think, counter to what most people have believed. That is changing, and I'm going to come back to that in 1 second. And it's changing because we see that turnover is actually quite high. And so, particularly in the last year, most of the growth that is still coming is relying on new participants, but it's not enough to sustain the people who are exiting. Half of the people who participate have exited within 12 months. So it's not a story of deepening either in terms of participation or share of income over time. And we see that this is particularly true as the labor market more generally is getting stronger, so that the mix of the people who work on these platforms is changing quite considerably. I mentioned age and income and otherwise, but we see that increasingly the pool that remains in these platforms is less likely to be employed, although many still are. They tend to be lower income, those that stay, and they tend to drop out at much faster rates when they do get employed. So critical pieces of information and critical profile to the broad policy debate that is taking place right now as to whether these workers should be considered contractors or full-time employees, what role benefits should play. John and I were chatting before, what role should their investments play in this, and how should the employers treat that? And how does this fit into the overall picture? The most important finding relative to work that we normally do on all Americans and their income profiles and otherwise is that for labor participants, their participation on platforms is helping to offset dips in income that are actually quite common. Most Americans face very high levels of income and consumption volatility, and for those labor platform participants we see, they tend to participate when they've had a dip in income, and they participate just to the level of offsetting that dip in income. So that is fulfilling an important need in the market, but of course it is not leaving open the question of benefits and other protections, Social Security, unemployment insurance, workman's comp, et cetera, that more traditional jobs have provided. That's a quick preview, and certainly encourage you, since all our research is out in the public domain on our website and otherwise, to turn to our reports if you're more interested in that. Thanks.
Thank you, Diana, and Betsy will speak next.
Thank you all for having me. It's truly an honor. I am going to click through some slides here when we get these up. What I thought I'd do, Diana just gave a great overview of, I think, what we see in this economy here in the US. I thought I'd give you a bit of an sort of a sense of how we think about this at Uber, and in particular, provide a bit of a global context. That's something I spend a lot of time thinking about. Before I get started, I just wanted to remind everybody of Uber's mission. It's an important point for me whenever I think about the labor side of what we're doing. We are out to provide reliable, affordable transportation for everyone, everywhere. And this image for me is always a great reminder for those of you, likely many of you, who know LA. I think it's 200 or 300 miles of coastline that we're looking at there. And the way that the service has expanded to provide very reliable transportation options, even in very sort of low density areas like LA, is actually remarkable. And I think the on-demand nature of the platform is really key to that. Now, Diana talked a lot about some stats you've likely heard from Uber in the past around our drivers and other on-demand workers, how they use the system for flexibility. It's often very part-time. That is very much a US story. And I just wanted to ground everybody in what we see on the policy side when we're looking at a global marketplace. So here in the United States, you have an example there of California. It's really easy to get started as a driver. And that is what motivates a lot of the usage behavior that Diana talked about. It takes just a couple hours of somebody's time, $10 in California. We run a background check on their criminal history. We run the MVR, their motor vehicles records. We check their vehicle, and we do that for the state of California and make sure it's roadworthy. And then they can get going. It's really easy. It's all just in the app. In a lot of other countries in the world, that's just not true. And there's a couple examples up here. I was in Brussels last week, so these are sort of the ones that had been front of mind of Paris and Munich. And as you see, I think it's, what, 2,000 euros to get started in Paris as a driver. And it can take as many as 9 months to get through all the tests that are required. In Munich, the drivers, to get the type of license that's required to use our platform, have to go through an equivalent test as the knowledge test in London that black cabbies go through. So they could spend years studying for this and have the map in their head. And so for us, we actually do see that in some places, a lot of the people using our platform are using it full-time as their primary source of income. That's not what we see here in the US, but it is what we see in large parts of Europe, in many parts of Asia. And so from our perspective, the platform itself is really flexible, and it facilitates a lot of different ways of working. Now, this is Paris. And this is, I think, what gets us most excited is really this when you look at the people who are actually getting access to work through the platform. Diana talked about this a little bit in terms of the lower income people tend to be the people who continue using it. I think what you're seeing here in Paris is on one side you've got a map of where unemployment is in the city, and on the other side where our drivers live. And there's a fairly high correlation between the two. I think this is 45% of our partners are coming from parts of Paris that have unemployment rates above 15%. We've also studied, we've done a lot of studies on our drivers in Paris. 40% of them were, 40% of 20%, sorry, I always get this wrong, 20% were unemployed before starting their work with Uber. And 40% of those, so somewhere around, 10-12%, were unemployed for over a year. And that's a really remarkable number of people who just had no access to work and are now able to earn income. When we look at this globally, the numbers are even more staggering. So in Mexico, 50% of these drivers were unemployed before using Uber. In Egypt, 40%. And this is true across the developing markets. So I wanted to touch quickly on the range of people. Now, this is a very much a US story, but it's true everywhere. This platform is so flexible that people who have a hard time getting work are suddenly able to do so. So what you're looking at, the man there in the light blue shirt, is deaf. And we are able to provide on our platform a way for deaf people to actually earn money in a really reliable fashion. In the US, I believe the unemployment rate among deaf people is 70%. And so for these people, this is suddenly an opportunity for them to earn income, something we're really proud of. We also see a fairly large number of women using the platform. I believe we're over 25% in the US now. Veterans who, you know, veterans often face a lot of barriers to get work because they move around so much. And so for when they're in the military and then afterwards. So when they're in the military, their families are using the platform as they move around. It's an easy, consistent way to earn money. And then afterwards, they have an easy way to come back into the workforce. And just really quickly, because I think many people, when I come to events like this, have seen Uber as a rider. You know what that app looks like. It's very familiar to you. But very few people have actually seen it as a driver. So I just wanted to show a little bit of that, so you see what it's like to actually work on the platform. On the left-hand side there of the screen is what a driver is looking at when he's out driving. And you see these red hexagons, which show him where the highest areas of demand are in a city. And so he can move to meet those areas of demand if he chooses. We also try to provide really easy transparency into weekly earnings. That's something the product team continues to look at, is like, how can we do a better job there? And it's an area of innovation for us. And we try to give real, not transparency, but transparency and then learnings from the ratings that riders are giving the drivers, so we can give them tips on how to provide better service. We've also done a fairly large number of product innovations, which have rolled out in the US first, that I think, you know, if you're not a driver, you don't think about the pain points that the driver is really experiencing day to day. So one that's not, there's not an image of it here, but a driver comes to pick you up and you take 10 minutes to get out of your building. That's 10 minutes of lost time. He's not earning money. And so in the United States now, if you order a ride, 2 minutes after that driver shows up, you're starting to pay for that ride, even if you're taking your time to get downstairs. And that's just something we can do on the back end to make the driver's life easier. We've also got a partnership with a fuel card here in the US that provides drivers discounts on fuel. And we've built an API integration with them that allows us to actually put on the map where the fuel stations are and what the real-time prices are. So that helps drivers get access to the cheapest fuel that they could find. And then finally, this the screenshot that you're looking at, we've launched a feature we call driver destinations. It allows a driver to say, you know, I'm going to be going to this part of the world. So if I'm in Palo Alto, I'm driving to San Francisco. I'd like a ride that's going to dispatch me along that same route. And that allows drivers to effectively make money while they're commuting. And so they can do that twice a day. And just a few final sort of comments on improvements that we're focused on for the drivers. You know, people talk about benefits a fair bit, and we've been looking at how we can strike partnerships to provide at-scale deals for our drivers. There's just a couple up here that I'll go through. On the left-hand side is a partnership with a company called Betterment. It's a startup bank, and this is providing our drivers easy access to and then direct sort of movement of their income into a high-interest savings account. And there's very little we can do in a 401k to make it tax preferred, but we are trying to help them save if that's something that they're trying to do. In the middle is a program called Instant Pay, and this lets drivers get paid the instant that they earn the money, so they don't have to wait for the paycheck to hit their account weeks later. And then this one on the right-hand side, you'll have to excuse me as my brain is full and I wait to be reminded of what it is exactly. I think this is the Stride Drive integration. So Stride is a startup company that has been providing healthcare navigation tools for independent workers across the industry. They've also worked with us to build something called Stride Drive, which helps drivers automatically estimate their costs. And that makes it much easier for them when they go to file taxes, that they can actually deduct costs in a meaningful and accurate way. So that was just a quick overview I just wanted to run through to set the stage for a conversation.
Well, great. Well, thanks. Well, let's get the discussion started. So let me start by picking up on something that both of you talked about, which is the nature of work that's being created on these platforms. So, Betsy, you made an interesting point that the barrier to work on Uber, at least in the United States, is extraordinarily low. You can get a job in less than 2 hours. And Diana, you had made a point that's related to this, which is that facilitates a lot of experimentation. People can go and try out driving. In fact, we had a faculty member at the business school this fall who was driving for Uber for a while, but he came back full time to be a professor at Stanford. So one question I have is, as the experimentation dies down, and this book we think, you know, going out, are these platforms going to be primarily a source of full-time work, or is it going to be more part-time work? Will it be supplemental? Will it be something you do if you have childcare at home? How do we think about that generally? And in the case of Uber, is the business model agnostic to that, or is that something you have a preference over the type of workers, jobs you're creating?
Well, let me provide maybe a broader view, and then we can hear from Uber specifically. I think this conversation, at least the way we've defined the online platform economy, sits in a broader conversation that folks like Alan Krueger and Harris had sort of done some work in more broad base, which is independent workers and contractors in general, of which this piece is only a small part. And so let me answer your question at that level. At the level of independent workers, there's no question that that has been rising quite significantly, not quite at the rates that I was describing for the OPE, but more of the labor force is becoming some form of independent contractor and worker. And a lot of that is by choice. There was a recent McKinsey Global Institute survey, that was another home of mine before, but that sort of shows a lot of this is people seeking flexibility, seeking otherwise, and that would tend towards the answer to your question being, yes, we're probably going to see more of that. Generational surveys suggest that millennials tend to go in that direction, et cetera. But I think that the phenomenon that is the online platform economy had this moment of great enthusiasm about how this was going to solve a lot of problems. And I think as people really start experimenting, and it's not just Uber, I want to make sure we don't equate this entire, you know, we're talking about 40 different platforms. There's a lot of different things going on and different experiences from that. But I think that euphoria has given rise to many of the things that have more traditionally been issues in the workplace in general, like benefits, like insurance, like and to your point, John, investment, because many of the folks, whether they were Airbnb providers or car service providers, will say afterwards, well, it sounded great because I didn't think there was an incremental cost. I already have the car, I already have the apartment, and it turns out that no, there is a cost. There's more wear and tear, there's more need for investment, and fewer people are finding it a little less worthwhile doing it, which is why we've seen the kind of growth rates peak down. So I don't know what the answer to your broader question is. I would say, look, when there's a phenomenon in the labor market that is growing this quickly, this is when you want to step in and say, what about this is good? And I would say this of helping workers find work when they want quickly and offset income volatility is really important, and that's good. But there are a lot of things that are making this harder and less worthwhile for people after their short bout of experimentation, and can we fix those? And we can turn to some of those pod prescriptions.
Yeah, I would agree with most of that. I think in the Uber case, I don't know what the future holds. Obviously, if I did, that would make me a very wealthy person. But I think for Uber, we still see a lot of usage of the platform that is part-time or flexible in that way. I don't know that that necessarily means those people have to continue doing it forever. So take a student who's going to do this during the summer, and they maybe have a different job that they're working on at that period of time, or someone who wants to go back to school but still needs to earn a bit of money to pay the bills. So I think there are a lot of use cases for this platform that fit the part-time, flexible work model that will continue to be there for people, and it's nice to have an opportunity for those folks to earn income they wouldn't otherwise have. That doesn't mean we don't see full-time usage of the platform. We absolutely do. And I expect we'll see a hybrid of that for a long time in the US.
Yeah. Let me ask a question which is somewhat of a follow-up, but pertains to the relationship between platforms and their contractors. And this picks up on what you said, Diana. So many of us saw the video a few weeks ago of the Uber driver who made the argument that told the story that he had invested in a black car, and then when Uber went in with their UberX product, he had trouble recouping the investment that he had made in his car. And I think that, for me, that was a very interesting anecdote because it raises the question of what is the responsibility that a platform owes to its contractors? Is it akin to the relationship that a firm owes to its employees, or are they at risk as contractors for investments they make, whether it's human capital or physical capital and so forth? How do you think about that?
Yeah. It's obviously been an interesting few weeks at Uber, so I'm not going to comment on most of that. But in regards to your specific question, so I think the way that we think about this is we don't actually know what the driver is doing with the car. And so it's very hard for us to be deterministic or sort of give specific guidance on what types of investments to make. There are plenty of drivers who have these cars and get all kinds of value out of them that has nothing to do with using Uber. That said, I do think that we have a responsibility, and I think it's one that we take seriously and are working on getting better at, to educate the drivers and to give them tools that help them manage their costs more effectively. And I think, like any small business, you know, if you think about trying to start a private hire business, private hire being, you know, car service business 10 years ago, how would you even know where to get started in that? And we can help people get started and actually make it much easier for them. There are efforts underway. You know, I have spent a lot of time in London recently, and in London we're putting a fair bit of effort into helping drivers understand which cars are going to be most cost effective to them. And in particular, if they're undergoing lease arrangements or rental arrangements, how is that actually going to be cost effective? And that's partly because in London we know they're all full-time drivers, and there's a very different sort of setup there. In the United States, it's just not true, and we don't know as much about how people are using the assets that they invest in. I think we can do as much as we can on fuel, on helping them with taxes. We get them deals on things like Jiffy Lube and tire changes, and we do have, I think, a responsibility to continue working on that.
So I would add to that, kind of more generally, again, beyond the Uber-specific situation, that there's something... There are two pieces of this that have to go together. And maybe the challenge that we have right now is that these business models are evolving in very creative and innovative ways that allow certain things to happen, but without the kind of infrastructure from a societal point of view that makes it work for everyone over a period of time. So if you think about this question of how responsible should an employer be for investments that people make, whether they know what they're going to do or not, for healthcare, for workman's comp, et cetera. You know, if we had an infrastructure where those things were divorced from the work, and in effect there was a network that was providing that, or portability associated with that, well then you'd say, great, this is actually a lot of flexibility for the worker, for the employer. They're building a business model that isn't carrying that. But we can't have our cake and eat it too. We can't say that's, you know, historically became part of the compensation packages, partly driven by tax reasons, et cetera, and we're going to strip it out, especially because the consequences for society can be very detrimental. So if it is primarily young people who are participating in these platforms, those are the people that are required, for example, for healthcare pools to work for everyone. And so if you're culling out a time and providing, take them out, not providing system, we can't solve an infrastructure problem for society and just let people pick off the things that work for them. So I think that's an important challenge here that we haven't thought through.
Well, do we need to make, as you say, a lot of benefits for workers are their healthcare benefits and retirement benefits are tied to full-time work, and the policy pieces are not there to support people who are doing contingent work. Do we need to make policy changes to acknowledge that this is the future? This is where things are going toward contingent work?
I think most people would argue we do, but exactly what those changes should be is where the debate is. And I think there was a lot of motion led by Senator Warner and others around maybe what we need to do is a new classification, not contractors, not employers, but something else that begins to grasp this. And I think initially some of those conversations were being taking place void of any real facts and data on this. It's just in some ways the way we got involved in this and the way Kruger and others started doing work in this area. And so I do think we're going to need to evolve this. And frankly, our work system and our benefit system is very antiquated. It speaks to an economy that was really of another time. But exactly how we move toward a new frame in light of the kind of conversations that we were having just now politically, you know, different question.
Let me turn to regulation. So I think let me start with you, Betsy, on regulation. So, you know, Uber's gone into cities and had in the US and into cities in Europe, and it's often been contentious in terms of the regulatory structure. And do you think that we're in the right place with regulation? How do you feel that, I mean, how do you see Uber's regulatory interactions going forward from where they are right now?
Yeah. So I have a background in internet privacy, and I never thought that I would become a transportation policy expert. But I now know a fair bit about transportation policy. And, you know, I think a lot of the challenges that Uber faced going into a lot of these cities is that you have regulatory structures for taxi and private hire limousines or minicabs, depending on which part of the world you're in, that started 100 years ago. They'd been built on in the, you know, 50 years ago. If you look at London, there's a long history of taxi protecting their existing setup when the minicab and private hire market started in the 1950s, and there was a very similar thing that happened as what's happening now with Uber coming in. I think for me, the difference with Uber is, you know, many transportation policies, you want to go back to first principles, right? So what were their first principles they're trying to solve for? Consumer protection, primarily. Safety, and that's the second big one. And I think on both of those, actually, technology has meaningfully changed the marketplace and the landscape of what's possible. And so there is a need to go back and modernize those rules and actually update them to allow the technology to solve the problem that you were sort of trying to solve originally. So take taxi cabs that have to have the fare smacked on the side of the car in some places, and that they have to have the taxi sort of be a particular color, they have to have a light on the top of the car. All of that is there for consumer protection. And it can be solved by what we have in the app, which is you get the license plate for the car that's picking you up, you get a photo and a name of the driver, and that way you know that the car that's coming to get you is the one that you're intended to be getting into. And you see the fare up front, and you pay the fare up front, you're sort of very clear on what you're paying for. And that, I think, just requires, on the regulatory front in the transportation world, some modernization. I think there's a much more interesting broad question that I'm sort of interested how Diana thinks about, which is this access to work, and what are the barriers to get access to work? And we see this play out, you know, in Vietnam, to start driving as a private hire driver, you need to have a brake glass axe in your car for safety purposes. If you don't have one, you can't get a license. And there are those sorts of barriers that we see. That we see additional testing, knowledge barriers. You know, in London, you may have just read that we'd actually gone into litigation with our regulator there, who had imposed a bunch of new rules. We won on many different pieces of this case, but the one that is going to be appealed is this piece around a test for English language skills. The English language test itself is not a problem, but there's a writing portion of it that the driver has to write an essay to be able to get a license to drive people around the city of London. And so I've become really interested in these different types of barriers for people to get access to work, and especially as you talk about sort of young people coming up, what are their opportunities? Is the economy sort of stagnating in some way? How do we actually create more opportunities to get access to work?
So I don't know that I have too much to offer to that, but I would offer another discussion item that plays into these online platforms. It's been in the news a little bit, which is that part of the promise of them were that they were democratizing access to a large degree, because if, you know, the criteria were very clear, and if you met the criteria, you weren't subject to interviews of people seeking the people who look like them and all this. So whether it was gender or race or even coming from a different income quintile or a different cultural background, the view was these were going to improve the situation. I think some of these platforms, some of the capital platforms in particular, have gotten into a lot of trouble around algorithms that actually are solving for trying to, you know, de-democratize these kinds of traits. So I guess it's just a lesson in, you know, the platforms are the platforms, they can move in any direction, and the cultural norms are not going to be entirely solved by technology. They will be used in the ways that the culture will use them, which means that regulation is going to have to play a role if we want to fix these things.
Well, that's a very interesting question, because I think we've all seen the stories about the studies, certainly those the about evidence of discrimination, for example, on Airbnb or on the Uber platforms. And do the platforms, should they be responsible for what happens in their marketplaces, for the interactions that happen between riders and drivers, or between hosts and guests on Airbnb? What How much is that responsibility borne by the platform that facilitates that interaction?
Yeah, the way that we think about it at Uber, we have a set of community guidelines that riders and drivers adhere to, or intended, we intend for them to adhere to them, and when they violate them, they'll lose access to the platform. And those community guidelines have things like no discrimination requirements in them. Now, I think in our business, there's an interesting history, which is a taxi driver who will not pick up the African American at the airport, or who asks where you're going and then refuses to take you because he doesn't want to drive you to that area. And I think the app has had a democratizing effect for some of those situations. I think the question of, are there disparate impacts from the types of algorithms that are now being deployed is a super interesting question. It's one I know that we're sort of studying, and I hope others are, because I don't know that there's an easy answer here.
Right, I don't think there is an easy answer, but I do think that, even with the recent Supreme Court ruling on, we have to force people who participate in market activity to abide by law. Like, that should be a minimum standard. Now the laws will get reinterpreted in different ways, but I think that this will give rise to, I suspect, many more lawsuits, and we're just beginning to see the beginning of that.
I'm gonna ask a question about automation, and then I'll turn it over to the audience. So, I think when I think about Uber, but also about a lot of the other labor platforms, where people are hiring coders or doing relatively, perhaps menial tasks, and they're outsourcing them online. I wonder if those jobs are going to be around in 10 years. And I'm curious as to, first of all, how do you see that? And then secondly, are the same market structures that we've put in place to facilitate jobs going to be the same ones that support automation? For example, if we have autonomous vehicles, are they going to be facilitated by Ubers and Lyfts, or are they going to be, it's going to be a totally different disruptive force that will change the marketplace?
Yeah, it's a super interesting question. So, Uber has obviously a very large investment in the autonomous vehicle space. We now have cars on the road transporting passengers in Pittsburgh and in Tempe, Arizona. And the way that we think about it is, this technology is good, it's very good, but it's not perfect yet. And if you're going to go buy a car, you want that car to work 365 days a year, 7 days a week, 24 hours a day. And the fact is, the technology is not there yet. And so for us, we're sort of thinking about it as a fleet approach. So if there's a fleet of cars that can take you around in a ride-sharing network, and some of those are autonomous, the network will continue to work even when it starts snowing and the technology kind of stops working. And that, I think, we view this as a hybrid approach for a very long time. We don't imagine that you're going to see every car in the country swapped over to a self-driving car in any, in 10 years. I think the other thing that's super interesting on this question is that people tend to assume a very static approach, static view of the world. It's somewhat human nature to think that the world looks the way it does today. It's hard to imagine how it will look when it changes. But if you think about the deployment of a self-driving car, cars today are used 4% of the time. They sit idle in parking spots 96% of the time. It's a tremendous waste of all sorts of things, assets, land, all kinds of things. When you have self-driving cars, you may be able to achieve a much higher utilization of that asset. But that means that asset's going to be, as you sort of alluded to, when there's higher utilization, there's higher wear and tear, there's more maintenance. These are going to be highly technical. Automated cars are technical. They're not just mechanical. And so the types of jobs you're going to need for servicing them is going to look very different. And that's just one small example of how I think we assume this static view of the world, but actually it's very hard to predict how it's going to change. And you can just start to see these angles, but you still don't know what it'll look like.
So I agree with that. And I would just add something we all know, that this discussion of automation and robotization and driverless vehicles and otherwise, it's just a much more profound question than any of these platforms, mm-hmm. although I guess the driver, car sharing are sort of on the forefront of this. But people talk a lot about that, how many people, particularly the most vulnerable, unemployed, less educated, et cetera, are sort of going to be subject to that. And I think that's super important. It's very profound. I think we will see very, very large changes. in the next while. But the part that doesn't get talked about quite as much, but I'm maybe as concerned about, is knowing what I know about data, machine learning, artificial intelligence, given what we're doing at the Institute. A big part of what these platforms are doing are collecting an enormous amount of information and data on things that were services to a large degree. So put aside the people who will drive a car or hammer a thing or weld a thing, many, many service operations that were thought to be constrained to non-automation, non-robotization, because they required some kind of judgment. Well, the more data we have on what judgment calls are being made by real humans making those decisions over time, the more that those can be culled and algorithms develop to say, well, this is what good service looks like, this is what doesn't. And so it opens up not just the things that are so obvious that could begin to be automated and begin to be roboticized, but maybe other things that just required a situational contextual understanding. And I don't know that there's much we can do about that or should do about that, but it is an accelerator in a way that I don't think is being talked about quite as much.
Well, great, Diana, thank you. That's great, thank you for these answers. And Diana, this is fantastic so far to hear about all the broad context and Betsy about the Uber context. And I wanna just actually take 1 minute before we turn over to Q&A acknowledge Betsy getting up here in front of this audience after what has been a pretty difficult media weeks for Uber. And you know, we've all been in difficult situations. We've had to get up in front of audiences, and I want to just commend her for stepping up and doing that. So
thank you for having me. It's a great opportunity I otherwise would not have had. So thank you.
So let me open it up for the audience and give folks a chance to ask some questions. So who'd like to go first?
Oh. Hi, this is a question about Uber. I have read that there are as many as 40,000 additional cars on the streets of San Francisco these days due to Uber and Lyft drivers coming in probably from the suburbs. Mm. And I'm wondering what your thoughts are about what that does for traffic, and maybe it's a tipping point to cause a congestion tax. Mm. But it's a very interesting problem.
Yeah, it's a super interesting, transportation in general I found is a super interesting problem. I don't know if there are transportation economists in the room, but you know, transportation is very peaky in its demand. So it's got very high peaks of how much demand there is and then very low, slow troughs of low demand. And what that means if you're actually trying to build a transportation network, just from an infrastructure perspective, is you have to actually invest in that full capacity to meet the peak of demand. This is why public transit is, I think, a very hard thing to get a profitable return on, because you're investing in this capacity that then is not utilized for large portions of the day. So, you know, I think that is sort of where I start from when I think about this problem. I know the New York number is a little bit better, so I might speak about New York, but it's a very similar phenomenon. In New York, I think there's something like, I know them a little bit better, but not that much better. So it's something like 35, 40,000 cars in New York, and something like 6,000 of those cars are on the road at any given time. It's still a lot of cars. It's actually fewer than taxi in New York. But the point that I wanted to make is, there may be that many people who are registered to drive with Uber, but that doesn't mean they're all on the road at the same time, right? And they are sort of meeting these demand peaks in ways that suit their schedule, and it does sort of get to this question of work, is the fact that it's so flexible enables people to drive when they want to, when it suits them, to move things around for whatever schedule they might have in their personal life, and as a result, you're gonna hear these very large numbers that do not reflect the full set of cars on the road. Now again, just to think about what you're sort of pegging it against, that's not true for taxi. So taxi medallions, typically, the way they work is you rent out a taxi medallion for 12 hours a day, then you bring the taxi back in and another driver takes it out, and so that taxi is out on the streets 24 hours a day. And so the comparison you'll often hear is there's, you know, tens of thousands of Uber cars on the street and there's only 3,000 taxis. But you have to keep in mind that utilization question when you do that comparison.
Diana, in your opening remarks, you said that only 1% of people have participated in the U.S., or 10 million Americans, and so by no means is this the future of work. I'm curious to hear your thoughts on what you think is the future of work.
Let me clarify one point. So 1% of adults in any given month, the 10 million is the 4% of adults that would have participated cumulatively. Not so clear before. So I think that what we're seeing with elements of what I described in this online platform economy will probably replicate themselves in elements of what the future of work looks like, so that you will have more flexibility in scheduling as a general rule than there was in the past. So you will have more of a modularity to payment, if not necessarily piecemeal per task or per service, more a sense that you're project-based and paid on a project, and you know you can come in or out. Because I think that that was part of what caught fire with a lot of these platforms, where those were elements, and I think many employers, very large employers like JPMorgan Chase or Google or others, are finding that like if they want to get the talent they want to get, they're going to have to start being responsive to that. Having said that, it's more on the margin. I mean, you know, these are, if you think about how large our labor force is, and you think about how, I mean, just as another set of work that we've done, you know, almost 50% of employment is in small businesses of under 10 employees. So, you know, we're not going to transform all that very, very, very quickly. So I think we will see some of these elements. I hope, although I don't know that I have reason to hope, that the future of work will involve some recognition of increased portability for some of the things we've talked about, benefits and Social Security contributions or otherwise, because then a lot of the benefits of this can be gotten without some of the drawbacks. But I don't have too much optimism given the political situation.
Stacey, I think that'll be welcome news that we're going toward modular work. Stacey's the CEO of TaskRabbit, so she has a stake in some skin in the game. John, how about you?
You described some formidable barriers to become an Uber driver in Europe. Are you working at eroding those? And what is the progress?
So, you know, we have a very healthy business in London and Paris in Europe. And I think in other places, the barriers are just very, very high. We do have a business now in Madrid. We actually have a business in Berlin, which, you know, we have a very healthy business in Poland. These are not fast changes that you're talking about. And so I think it will take time to get the regulatory change that we need in some of these countries. It's certainly something that we're working very hard on.
Got a microphone back there.
So besides Uber, there are the car sharing services, especially in San Francisco. Lyft is one of them. So my question is, does Uber have a plan to increase the competition to become monopoly, or Uber has the plan to collaborate with Lyft and other companies to provide better customer experience or benefit for the drivers?
So it's a bit of neither is the short answer. But I think that the fact that there is a healthy competitor is what is driving a lot of the product innovation I spoke about earlier. It's a two-sided market. We have two sets of customers, in effect. One is the rider base. The other one are the drivers. And those drivers in this country have a very nice option to go to Lyft if they want to. And in fact, many of our drivers use both Uber and Lyft at the same time. And that means that we actually have to compete really fiercely for their loyalty. And that means building products and services that are actually going to make their lives easier. You know, and we talk a lot about benefits in the policy discussions. But again, I think when you talk to a driver, their pain point is something very different. Their pain point is, how do I find affordable gas without having to drive all over the city to look for it? And so we're really focused on, you know, the driver experience right now and investing a lot of our engineering talent into trying to make that as good as possible.
Does the comp? I'll just ask one, and then we'll get to this next one. But does the how much is the comp? Does the competition affect what drivers get to earn between the platforms versus just the competition between the drivers or the or what Uber is doing? Diana mentioned that the earnings are falling for workers on these platforms, and yep. what's going into that from what you're seeing?
So we actually have seen earnings remain remarkably stable in the U.S. over a period of years. It's something that we look at very carefully. I think the competition directly, I don't think it affects earnings all that much. I think what is a bigger effect on earnings are periods of high demand and whether or not you've got sort of a healthy marketplace.
I'd be interested in each of your comments on minors participating in these marketplaces, folks under 18. Obviously, there are not many Uber drivers under 18, but there are a lot of teens who rely on Uber despite the fact that the terms of service are only for members 18 and older. And on the supply side, there are many marketplaces where teens are programming or providing other services, often with the clients not knowing that. Can you talk about sort of the regulatory or the ethical trends?
I'll let you talk about Uber, but for the window that we see, we look at adults, and we actually know they're adults because they have to be customers of the bank, which hits different screens that are much higher than just saying you're old enough to participate. So I can't really inform your question directly, but I'll tell you the flip of it that has been really valuable from the lens that we have is what's happening to 65 and older, because often people talk about workforce and they are referring to kind of 18 to 54 year olds. And what we're finding is what large number of otherwise retired people are participating in these platforms in different ways. And also, the age question is a very interesting one. Unfortunately, I don't have a view onto the demand side of it. And on the supply side of it, at least what we see, we know they're adults because someone's checked their Social Security and their form of ID and otherwise. So.
I mean, we're certainly, as you mentioned, it is against the terms of service for a teenager to use the platform. I think we'd like to find a product solution for that, and I think that is the Silicon Valley approach, which is build the product solution for it. I would just like to second, though, this interesting point about people over 65. And we've done a few surveys on drivers to try and get at this. I don't have any quantitative data to share, though. What I do have is just anecdotes, right? So if you get the drivers who are picking you up and they're driving for 3 or 4 hours in the morning every day, they're retired, but that gives them a reason to get out of bed, something to do, it's social, it's an outlet. And I do think there's something super interesting happening with that population in these platforms.
Well, I can say as a parent of three millennials, a lot of those cars on Friday, Saturday night are keeping my kids in the road safer. Mm-hmm. So they're more responsible than some earlier generations on things like that. So thank you for that. One of my questions actually also, I was going to try to ask to Ruth Porat, but this concept of contract employee, non-benefit, kind of employee light is actually becoming very prevalent among traditional full-time employers that have big buildings and big parking lots too. Interested in your perspective on how contract versus full-time is permeating traditional working places. And then secondly, just more of a logistical, how are these employees, or are they properly captured in employment data in the United States? And just, are they overlooked, or has it worked there? Thank you.
So I can answer the data question because, frankly, part of the reason we got interested in this, we're really trying to map the financial and economic well-being of Americans through the work the Institute is, but we got pulled into this discussion because the data on these are very weak. So you have, on the one hand, 1099s, which is one view of it. On the other hand, those things are self-definitional. People kind of decide which bucket they're going to describe themselves at. So for some of the labor platforms, people will classify themselves all kinds of different ways. They'll say, I'm self-employed because they're self-employed at Uber. They'll say, no, I'm an employee because Uber's my employer. And so that has made some of the surveys, which is how even the Census and BLS get their information, very unreliable as it relates to this independent workforce. So I think we're in a bit of a new man's land, new person's land on the data on this. And it's being constructed. And to be fair, the Census understands this and is trying to do a better better job with this. There's not a huge constituency today in Congress for funding important data statistical offices, and that's a real shame. I think we're losing an infrastructure that was made the U.S. great, and one of the reasons we have so many incredible economists working in this country is because we had this extraordinary data infrastructure that we're not maintaining. So that's another thing you could get me off on. Let me just answer that part of your question.
Yeah, I would second everything that she just said. On the broader question, I actually don't have too much commentary. I think that the sort of labeling is a bit of an older way of thinking about the problem, and I think much more about how independent is this worker, and you know that I think is a much more interesting way of thinking about it. But in everything in this space, you go back to this data question, and I can't sort of second that enough. That what Diana's just said is really critical.
Just to add to that, so there was a question for many years on the American Community Survey, which is the long form census, which asked whether you were on contingent work. And that was how we tracked for many years what was going on in contingent work, and it was dropped from the ACS in 2005. And there was a span of about 10 years where we had no data on what was happening on contingent work until Alan Krueger and others did a survey, got it added back in. And that gave us another data point after more than a decade of nothing, and there was this enormous rise in contingent work. And that, you know, but it just shows, it actually shows how important investment in national statistics are, because you can miss some really big change in the labor force just by not collecting the right data through a, you know, whatever reason. So that was really an important additional observation.
Just realized we didn't address at all the first part of your question, and it's a really important one, because the second one is so important to those of us who do research in this area. But this question of traditional employers and their role in how much they're using contracting or not, I think that is a general view. There's more of that going on, a lot of piecemeal. But there is something that we need to be very concerned about as it relates to the future of work of that. So if it creates flexibility and mobility and things that are good, it does not as much create career paths. It gives you a job, it gives you a paycheck. But one of the things for all that people love to hate big companies, that big companies have done, is provide not just a paycheck and a job, but like a path for mobility as people get to know you and experience. And the more we move to just project-based piecemeal, the less you see kind of an evolution of a career, which is going to be essential to people rising income over their lifetimes. And that's something that that I think traditional employers have done a better job of.
Couldn't it be true, though, that some of the platforms facilitate business creation as opposed to just individual employment? So on Airbnb, for example, you could run a small hotel business. In fact, some people do seem to run a small. I don't know if people do that on Uber? Can they run a small business on
Absolutely.
Uber?
Absolutely. We've seen a lot of folks build fleets and sort of become a fleet owner and have several cars. But I also think that there's a lot of validity into this comment about career paths, and it's a really interesting one.
Maybe one more question back here.
I had a question for Betsy. Does Uber feel, and without placing blame, but I know we have family living in Mexico right now, and they say that when you use Uber in Mexico, you have to be really careful in some cities because there's such animosity from taxi drivers, and they'll resort to violence against Uber drivers if they find out that you're, so they don't use the placards, and you have to be, you know, apparently really low key about, and you ride up front and just kind of pretend it's your friend. But because they're not employees of Uber, does the company try to, you know, does it try to take any measures to mitigate that or educate those drivers or try to do anything at the sort of government level to try to mitigate that?
Yeah, I haven't heard this problem come up in Mexico, so that's interesting for me. South Africa is a case where we see this the most, actually, is just an incredible amount of violence. Drivers who may be sort of mobbed by taxi drivers waiting to set their car on fire. And that is the type of violence that we're talking about. And we do feel a lot of responsibility for those people and making sure that they wind up in okay situations. It's a very hard problem, and you know, I think it's in some ways it speaks to the type of change that you're trying to provoke, that there are people on the other side that do resort to that level of violence. But that's the best answer I can give you right now. Yeah.
Let me give both of you a chance to make any closing comments that you'd like to make. You want to go first, Betsy, and then Diana?
Yeah, sure. Well, thank you for letting me join. I mean, I think this is a fascinating question and a fascinating set of areas and research to look into and continue exploring. And I think, you know, we'll continue to see ways in which platforms change not just work, but our access to a variety of different services. We've thought of them as internet platforms for a long time, and they're now sort of hitting the real world in a different way.
I guess I would just finish, since we're kind of wrapping up, with this sense of kind of wanting to celebrate the innovation that is inherent in all these sort of new models, the labor and capital platforms that we've been following, and yet the really important need to become informed, not just by anecdote or the experience of one company or others, as we try to take this into a policy environment. And I do think that maybe this crowd that has a commitment to economic research and yet is connected to policy can step up the constituency for doing this, collecting the data and really understanding an evidence-based policy, which I'm in fear of in the current context.
Yeah, and I think that's a great way to end, because you know, these are amazing. This is a sort of an amazing technological innovation, which has been followed by an amazing economic set of innovations around using marketplaces to create jobs and to create opportunities for people and to create products for all of us. And you know, maybe if we run this again in 10 years, the question will be about, you know, did we get the policy and did we get the regulation right, and did we put all the social infrastructure in place to around these platforms, assuming that they're still around and thriving in a decade, which of course we'll all have to wait and see. So thank you to both of you, and thank you to everyone, and we'll take a break now before the next session.
Great, thank you.